It's fine. So thank you very much. So I'm very happy to see you. Thank you for coming. So so part of the presentation she told us, now we will introduce each other. So Anna is a simultaneous interpreter from Kharkiv. She was teaching German and the theory of interpretation in Kharkiv, and she was as a staff interpreter. So she has also experience as an association of Austrian Austrian-Ukrainian Association. It was a company, so where was like the head of the interpreting service, and Anna is arranging, you know, the meetings in Kharkiv of interpreters. And so now it's Alexander from Odessa. So she's been on the market since 2013, and she has like four languages: English, Russian, Ukrainian, and German. So far, it's just the written form. And Alexander has favorite topics, favorite subjects, that's medicine, and it's law, and also logistics. It's like logistics can be favorite topic, and also Alexander in Odessa. And so she is also arranging the topics of interpreters, so who, where they are actually discussing professional standards. And here, so we need to say, so why we decided to come here to Utica and chose this topic. So why we chose it? So because of our profession. So we are usually saying someone's words, and here is a great, great opportunity to say my own text, my own words. And we are from Odessa and from Kharkiv, and this is interesting. And in different regions, so there are some peculiarities when we speak about the simultaneous interpreting or other interpreting. And Kyiv is, of course, is the most powerful city in many aspects, especially in the quality and the quantity of interpreters and interpretation, and why we have peculiarities here. So we travel a lot because up to now, you know, to interpret, you need to be physically aware, and logistics is very bad in Ukraine. You know, for 14 hours I was driving like in the car, and between Odessa and Dnipro, and I enjoyed it very much, kind of. And we are not studying how to do it, but from practice, so from the senior colleagues. So, and when you have a good association or some kind of a community, so like it's getting easier. So the interpreters who are still in the market, they're very ambitious, but to make ambitious and smart people into one association, so it's very good. And I would like to thank Vika Maros, so that they opened this this individual, like this track of interpreters separately, and thank you very much. And in regions, I can tell you the interpreters are not having such a sweet life, and everybody who wants to be an interpreter, all of them should go to Kyiv, or not like to move to Kyiv. I know there are other variants, and we are other we are other examples, and we are right now trying to support our new ideas, and how you can live and how you can develop living in the region as an interpreter. The first, you need some kind of a system that will help you. So, and these are the standards of what is good, what is bad, what is okay, and what is not acceptable. And such standards, like we can kind of put together our own standards, or kind of use standards at the only international conference of interpreting in 1953, AIC conference of interpreters was created, and right now, so the association is represented in 100 countries, and it has 2,100 members. And the standards are updated in AIC, and we decided to take these standards to use them, and to compare the standards with the professional words. And all these standards, they are there just to keep up the prestigious nation. So every standard we are going to illustrate with the examples from our interpreting. We wanted to diagnose where the standards and where we are, and we do not want to beautify anything. We are going to say what it is and to compare our standards, all the names and all the stories. They will be anonymous. So if you like the original standards, so they have 15 standards. We took just, we've taken just 10, you know, because the others, they're technical. We're going to speak about the 10 ones. If you have questions or commentaries, please, you know, we will try and give some time, you know, for discussions. Now we'll start standard number one, so agreement, like higher agreement. So they say that they should not sign this agreement about work. You know, if they do not know the concrete terms and conditions, they give this standard template agreement to sign. And also, I'm saying that just the under the key items. And now the copyright on the voice of interpreter. So, and then you need to agree with the client, also the recording of the voice. So, yeah, and the agreements are not signed, and it's just honesty, and this honesty is absent. So then the client is like pressurized, so they can be like online noise. And I would like to tell you the first anonymous story. So when this online, so this offline noise, and he came, you know, to the office of the client that did not open. So this person started opening all the doors and started telling everyone, the friends, you know. They said, listen, here is your fees, here is your fee, and here, thank you. And as for the agreement signed, so usually the big international organizations have these agreements, but they think it's a normal practice, but they are quite, sometimes they are biased, and they not to our benefit, and you cannot change them. For example, one of my colleagues, I'm not naming that, she tried to add some clauses about unhealthy conditions of work, but they say, no, we have the framework conditions. And also what is interesting, the agencies, the translation agencies, they are trying, you know, to sign agreements with the agencies, but the interpreters are not signing such agreements because according to these agreements, you can lose your fees, you know, for some miming, for the silent voice or loud voice, all that you did not answer the message of the agency within 1 hour. So the Nigel, you know, gave a good example of the best practices in our company, translation company. We are striving, you know, to the symmetry in the agreements, you know, so that the clients and the interpreters would be in equal conditions and terms. And we are speaking, we are like standard number two, how to annul or terminate the agreement, annulment from the side of the interpreter or from the side of the client. Even the interpreter is doing that, cancellation of the contract. and if he or she agrees, so you have to see if the initiator is the organizer, then AIC leaves the room for maneuvering. So just write it down in the contract, you know, who is paying for what. And now we continue the topic, and there was a colleague in Kharkiv, so got the order from one law enforcement organization. It was emergency exam, so you should have started, you know, this interpreting early in the morning. So she was on the way, and she was surprised when the client canceled everything like 40 minutes before, and of course nobody wanted to compensate her everything, though she canceled everything. So I would add some good things. And so the agency made a mistake, you know, called instead of the two interpreters, three interpreters, and paid all three, like for the day of work. So the next one is payment. Payment, it's all very short, so that they can give any tariffs. But in Ukraine, if there is no association of interpreters, so every interpreter is acting the way they want, and they actually agree on the conditions that the client agrees. The tariffs can vary between $50 to $500 per day. But we understand that the rate, the payment rate, is a different topic, and as I within our framework, just, you know, stop here as for the tariffs, and then we go to the. Okay.
This is the next item of IIC standards. So it says that if you do volunteering job for some charitable purposes, some oral interpreting, we should always correspond to standards of ethics code or any other standards. And we need to understand that they always try to support and foster very high level of professional skills of their interpreters, and just to foster the profession itself. So we just we're interested why our colleagues are engaged in volunteering work. So that's why we have had some questionnaire, and we have asked around 20 people, and all of them during all their career period from 1 to 10 years of career, and they told us that only 6 colleagues said that they have ever tried volunteering interpreting. So in such topics as medicine, education, ecology, mindfulness, meditation, any possible options of creative sectors like theater, music, literature. Why interpreters by chance or not by chance agree just decide to volunteer? Sometimes their professors ask their professors where they have been educated, and they didn't know how to just neglect to do it. Or some colleagues are interested in this topic, in this sector, and they are very ecologically responsible. And for example, one of our colleagues decided to volunteer to interpret on a volunteer basis in some of such events, and some of them just want to do it. And we also should mention UTIC, of course. Many of us have tried or will try, and I say UTIC is the one, but not least. We should not forget about this option in this event, and we also would like to give you a reference to a webinar of our colleague Anna Ivanchenko, and she just performed it around 1 year ago, if I'm not mistaken, and it's focused on topics of volunteering interpreting, and it's just saying that it supports IIC standards, and it means if you agree doing it, you should do it on the appropriate level. And our colleagues said that actually that they even in major cases or in half of the case they didn't read any materials for in order to prepare to this to their interpreting. And I about Nigel also, and he said about this topic, and he said it in the following manner: if we tell a client that this is free of charge, then the client could think that it's free. It means that it's of bad quality. That's why we say that it's not free, but it's such a discount. So, and if we understand, so we should understand that it doesn't matter you are paid or not paid. The quality should be the same. So let's go further. And the biggest clause in the standards is the team of the interpreters. Just to sum up, in a nutshell, we could find here how to calculate the number of booths and interpreters for any event. But I really like the beginning of this clause, given the physical and mental fatigue that are caused by sustained concentration. And all of us, we know that it's very difficult to interpret in oral manner because we always should sustain very high level of concentration. For me, high concentration is very important, and it's a very difficult topic because I clearly understand that I can't do anything without high concentration, even just to have a workout. And here, using these methods, we could calculate the minimum number of interpreters and booths. But what is important is that whispered interpretation and consecutive interpretation should be performed by two interpreters as minimum. So everything should be done in order to sustain high-level quality and just image of profession. But I think that interpreters in regions usually don't know how could be difficult oral interpreting in physical and mental manner, because it's very usually it's an exclusion, but not a rule to understand how it's difficult. Not always people know about whispering conference interpreting. I would just read this slide, and I would like to read clients' remarks. I can't understand why smile. Why there are two conference interpreters are needed? Please explain. So, without smile. The last comment is without smile. I didn't just create this. This is a real dialogue with a real client. So not all people understand this issue of high concentration and all other difficulties. And I should mention another topic and another station in terms of the standard. These are events with delegates and speakers from post-Soviet countries. So in these events, the interpreters could interpret into Russian or Ukrainian language, and they are expected to have normal standard language pair. But very usually, these events become three language events, and then it means just violating the standards. Our colleagues should interpret into Russian or into Ukrainian, and our colleagues just came into English language conference interpreting into Ukrainian language. And after lunch, people have been divided into two different groups, and in the main platform. English language pair can't be just supported by another pair of interpreters, so that they should have changed three different languages. And the very similar situation could happen with interpreters with two foreign languages. What that means in practice? For example, you could just take a client with Ukrainian Choman order. Event but you need to understand if there is an event with German and Ukrainian, at least one presentation will be could be on English. Just to look at benefits, one of our colleagues who worked in such event, Ukrainian German event, she managed to work additional pay to just gain additional payment for this English presentation. What is the next clause of the standards? What is it about? It's about the following miracle figures that interpreter should work not more than two sessions for 2.5-3 hours But in regions, this standard is very usually violated. For example, conference interpreters are very usually asked to help with interpreting during different coffee breaks, lunches, dinners, or even breakfast. As to the consecutive interpreters, I think the consecutive interpreting really has no limits. And 6 hours that have been agreed could become 10 hours, actually, or even 12 hours. So a very good method how to overcome it, and people just check it in practice. It could be a close an agreement as to the additional payment for overload, overburden, or out of schedule time. And as to the non-working days, and this is all aimed at for quality, and it means that agreement should additionally include time for reschedule for day off and so on and so on. But what we have, I would like to share with you one case. We have an interpreter that goes from Kharkiv to Nikolaev, and this is only one train. And this train goes 16 hours, according to our real Ukrainian landscape. Unfortunately, so according to schedule, train arrives at noon or at 2 p.m., something like this. And if event starts at 9 a.m., it means that interpreter should come earlier, and half of the day, previous day, should be wasted or should be spent in vain. But no one pays for this whole of the day. But I need to say about international organizations, and they are just one step forward, and they are ready to compensate this half of one of the day. They are very often ready to compensate only 120 hryvnia per 1 hour. And now we speak about logistics issues and about standards of quality of interpreting and logistics. These are, but okay, let's go further. And so, traveling. IC recommends to include into agreements all issues correlated with trips and business trips. What we have in practice, actually, not always interpreters have agreements because they just try to rely on dignity of clients. And clients sometimes cover traveling expenses, sometimes not. And just to share with you two cases. 25 trips, only 52% of trips have been covered. In the second case, among 15 trips, on 73 trips have been covered. The next one is close related to the days off. The session recommends to include all possible issues related to day off, to days off, or rest time after long-term trips in our region, in our landscape, is very strange thing, is very exotic thing. And I think that the maximum level that could compensate is just time wasted in vain. But we need to understand about terminology and definition, so it could be, we could have a dialogue. So about meals and accommodation. Again, association says that it should include all issues should be included into agreement. But in our regions, we should think how to change our definitions and terms. In our regions, usually there could be different views at accommodation and meals by different clients, because if accommodation is okay, everything almost clear, but for clients, and clients understand that they should provide accommodation for interpreters, but sometimes meals are not covered, and very often are not covered, and interpreters always should ask whether they have or not have these meals. And as to the money for each day, only half of the clients cover money for daily expenses. So we just covered all the most important standards. And in the beginning, we have said that that we would like to have this interactive session with you. Please share with us very frankly your practices. If you don't want to go into details, you could say colleague A, colleague B, and just for your convenience, we have prepared a list of standards on this slide. So the first question I would like to ask, look at this list and please tell. Among the standards, could you see any standards that directly or indirectly influence on quality of text that you just provide into microphone? Okay, so that our discussion is open. So we have a lot of time and quite, so we could have time for discussion. Let's have it.
So the first I would like to say that to see is like the non-working day, days of rest, and the travel days. So yeah, they do influence on the quality. If the organizers knew that the multi-day projects, and we are 2-3 interpreters, there will be doing simultaneous and consecutive and escort interpreting. So, and we came like 2-3 days before, so like we found out, you know, where things are happening, so we were checking all the equipment, and then they were working normally. We knew where, who, and when. So of course it's not quite an frequent way, you know, to get the presentation, but as for the conditions, several times in my practice the client was the ideal. It was on the territory of Germany, so it just got to my mind, you know, like who can boast that you would have the contracts where you could see the days, like that they were the rest days and the travel days. Okay. Yes, in reality, so I had such experience, and I can tell you that how you can put your leg between the door and the threshold, and then, you know, you can say if you do not have if you are not the individual entrepreneur, so, and then you could say you can give me the cashless, like you can just pay by my of course at first you could say okay, you can pay not by cash but on my account, and then you say okay, if you're paying my account then probably you need to sign the agreement. So but there are like different situations, there can be the best practices and the worst practices, and like the gap is like 6 months. It was the client who was like a bigger rights defendant organization, and I had to go to Canada to the business trip, and of course everything was covered, had to be covered, plus daily allowances, plus, you know, changing shifts, and also, you know, like 50% for each day also was paid, you know, while I was not working, you know, like 6 months later. So from a pharmaceutical Ukrainian company, you know, faced that they needed some workshop, and I was going there as like consecutive interpreting for several days. But as they say, you almost, you know, everybody knows English. Maybe during the workshops, if somebody is confused, and then I found out in 15 minutes usually that even the ones, you know, who understand English, they don't understand English, but they say the consecutive after each sentence, you know, we didn't count that. Okay, why don't you do the shushutash? I can do shushutash, the first shushutash. I can do it like I can resuming, but I cannot do it like alone, you know, shushutash. I was doing it for one person, you know. I was looking at that. So you made like 50 sentences, you know, before the lunch, you are not earning your money. And then after the lunch, you know, like more people came, and then 5 people. I cannot do chuchitash for 5 people. And so it was a very strange activist range event, and I'm not sure that I will go back to this client. But the thing is that there was no clear technical task. If we discussed it with the organizers, and if the organizers would think about it, then they could have avoided the situation. In this situation, so I'm just thinking about the trainees, you know, who did not get anything from that training. And I also had the case that everything was in the contract because I was writing the contract, and because I said that this should be included, okay. So I said that 2 days, you know, should be there. And then please include the, it was the military equipment, military interpretation. And then I said, we need also PPIU. That means like the personal protection kit also needed. So, but it was the flexible client, you know, and he actually came to all my conditions. And then it was last Thursday, so the translation agency is inviting for consecutive interpreting. It should be in the plant. So, and my Polish clients, like, are given the tour guides, and they are giving the microphone. I should do chuchotaj for 3 people. But this equipment was taken, you know, from the only provider for simultaneous interpreters. You know, what did you speak about? And they said, we speak to the consecutive. This is not consecutive. This is the simultaneous interpreting. So we will call the client. No, it's a consecutive. So we are right now at the plant. And the person who is doing that, you know, the ladies, the my Polish people are somewhere else, and I'm interpreting them. No, they said no, it will be consecutive. When it's going to be consecutive interpreting? It's about the technical. So the people just ordered the equipment. They understood what is going on. It's not the first time when they're ordering that. And here the interpreter is coming who is doing the simultaneous, and they say, no, it's consecutive. And it was in Lviv. And the second thing, you know, I don't understand why the client should pay for my days of rest. I understand when it's just the day when you're not working, and sometimes they're paying, but for the rest, I don't understand. I'm a freelancer. I can be having rest, you know, for 1 year. You know, I know. So you could see at the standards, the slides. So there was the definition. So it's the rest day after the long travel trip. So like Anya gave us the example. It's the Canada trip and you came, it's a jet lag. So, and then as if, you know, you came to the location and how long you will continue, you know, high quality. So I understand what it is. I think it's that time. Okay, I think it's just a dead time. So yesterday or the day before yesterday, so Anya called me for interpreting the day before that. So I had planned 3 days of interpreting, and then it was the flight by 2 planes. And then I had to work with Anna 2 days, and then my head starts thinking, now I understand. I'm the only resource, and I'm thinking about, yes, I'm losing my money, but what I would do, how I would interpret, I understand that I wouldn't go. I do not think that I will go there. I can add, you know, 2 other things. We understood that the dead time and the rest, what do you call, you know, dead time, or what do you call the rest? Maybe it's dead time because it's about logistics, or maybe it's because you need this dead time. But in both ways, it's, so the client, you know, should compensate us. And as for the tour guide example, so maybe they wanted you, you know, not to shout out, you know, all the equipment. So when I started writing to the agency that I have a microphone on my head, and they got this, and so the client says so that you would hear better. So and the other commentary to this. So as for the topic of the question, so there is the framework agreement. And but I think it's not like this at 120. Maybe it's the same agreement. So half of the people, you know, saying, yeah. So what can be added? So the absence of the the presence of the contract does not guarantee that people are following this contract. So I had a very sad, very, very sad experience. So they were doing the training in their very cool company, international. So it looks like the local organizer didn't put together the group. They were saying, you're giving the 3 days, but you in reality, you were working 1.5 days. But you see, this is my time, and I have the ticket. No, we will send to you the changed contract with amendments, contract with amendments. And so I talked to the person who is our legal consultant, and say, probably you misunderstood. No, you say, do you want to sue them? So I will help you. So there was a situation, it was very funny, so when it was the amended, it was amended variant, it was just the crossed out 3 and put with 100, like 2. It looks like the manager, so who was the Ukrainian-Russian manager, so that they just pocketed the money, you know, which is also possible, so because of the very, really cool international company, that is everything is white, and we were given in euro, you know, in cash in the end of the worker, and while the legislation is not developed, so if you sign the agreement, so you think, you know, it's not actually that they will follow the contract. But as the lawyer is saying, you know, like you have to make the agreement, so, but maybe you should go to the court with this contract. So I'll give the floor to Alexandra, so I will resume whatever you said, what I heard and what I understood. You think that the best points are like rest days and the non-working day or non-working days and the rest. Let's make the 3 best ones so that actually they influence you. Also, the team of interpreters. Team of interpreters, like non-working day and the rest days and the payment. Payment, who is for the rest day? I think that the payment is not discussed. What influences the quality? Logistic standards. So the team of interpreters and the working day and whatever is about logistics, it influences the quality. And then let's keep up, you know, like the time is not the rubber one. And there's like provocative questions. So do we have the people in the hall? So just say now or just be silent, you know, till the end of times. So which AIC standards cannot be implemented in Ukraine? So I will just vaguely answer. So it's a question with a question. So what do you think? why we want to accept some standards, why AICO should be interested to support the Ukrainian market of translation, so that they would be working with standards. So it should exist and work, you know, with some institutionalization. So just like if there is no institution, so that you can speak about like a failed agreement and everything, or that they will be amended, so it can be discussed. Why these standards should be working here if we do not have this consolidated market? It's about the regional interpreting, and it's a different country versatile marketing, and how you can do that.
So actual, realistic or not, everything depends on who could prepare such a base, a platform, who could just define this framework that will help foster to it. So yes, look, Sveta asks why association IIC should be interested in standards of Ukrainian oral interpreters. But so who should be interested in it? We should be interested in it. Who thinks that we, Ukrainian oral interpreters, should work in order to increase our standards of work? I don't hear. So that's the next question. So your idea like corresponds to, it's great that we think in one circle. So I would like to make one comment. Many years have been working as an interpreter for 20 years, and then I just moved into lecturing. And for the last 3 years, I've been living in Poland. And I am a lecturer without Russian, Polish, and matter actually. So my colleagues and in this language school, they're younger than me, and they work as interpreters in parallel. And they, for them, it's a very comfortable one, and they would not discuss these issues. Polish people, actually, they're very sure in themselves in all the sectors, in all levels of life. So as private entrepreneurs, they actually, in their work, from the very beginning, they have this list of work, like lecturing and so on and so on. So my colleague is 35 years old, and I communicated with this young Polish man. And actually, we discussed this issue. And as to this option, as where someone could not pay him, he can't even imagine this option. All of them, they pay taxes, and I work actually, and I pay taxes for, and being Ukrainian, I pay quite high figures. So 40 is option, the total figure, and 30 is the net one. So maybe we should achieve this level of self-dignity of as Polish people. And thank you very much for your comment and being coming back to the previous comment. It's great that we think the same. So our two final questions are the following. If you agree, or major part of you agree, that Ukrainian interpreters should increase their standards, how it's better to do it? Some of you could think that it's better to do just one by one with each client on individual base, in individual manner. So communicating with each client, old one, new one, you could just increase your quality, you could educate your client one by one, directly, face to face. Who of you think that that's the best way to increase your standards? I don't hear. So who thinks, yes, of course we do it, but who thinks that this is the optimum, the best option to do our work in order to increase your standards? Okay, the simple question. Who thinks that it's true? Please raise your hands. Okay. Then, who thinks that we need an alternative option in the form of any equity or enterprise or association that would stand for interests of interpreters? And the last question, and really we wanted to spend a lot of time on this question, so we will give you a microphone, so we have 15 minutes, and we will want to hear from you the next things. If you think, we agree with you actually, that in order to increase our standards and our quality and prestige, it's easier to do all together in common work. So how could you could you do it? Could be done? Could it be created a real vivid association of high intellectual, high ambitious people? How to create this very form that will let each member of this association not to feel some in an appropriate manner, but to feel on the appropriate level. Okay, just I'm very sorry if I will spend a lot of time. Please take microphone from me away if you think that it's time. So I would like to formulate the model about which I have been thinking a long time. The sense of this model is, in order to establish any association, we need to understand that any try to establish any association is just considered to be a try to become a tsar, a king, and to just to push under one person the whole market. My view, I need to say that my view is the following, that there should be an association that supports the profession, not an interpreter, not a client, but profession in general. We could just have as a platform IIC standards. We could just implement it through Facebook. We could use Ukrainian translators group on FB. If you are not in it, please join it. The author is Maxim Kosov, and he's very principal one, he's strict one. He can't be just become fooled by any person. So he could really understand how the platform could be created. So my model is that people are joined by one group, then they meet, understand standards, and agree that yes, we accept the standards. And if there are some disputable questions or issues with clients, it could be discussed with clients. And if the client says that I read in this according to the standards, that you just should provide a necessary level of quality, but you didn't come at all, or you are late in for 2 hours for my event. Of course, a community will say that you are not ready. Sorry, you are not on the necessary level for this profession. Why AIC is could be interested in it? Because international organizations really come here, come to this market, and they would like to be on the safe side. They would like to have guarantees, because communicating with us, they're just walking through the minefield, lucky or not lucky. For example, with UN organizations, there was such case, and they have had funny experience, and they asked me about my experience, and they have answered more than 10 years of interpreting, and how many conferences you interpreted, and I said 20 conferences, and I was proud of it, because my head of my scientific team, and so he just interpreted 15 conferences, and they said that you interpret only 20 conferences, and you position yourself as conference interpreter, and you have so little experience, and 10 years ago, I just was shocked how they could think about us. If they think that we are conference interpreters, but we are not ready to follow the standards. Yes, we need standards, but why we should invent any new bicycle? We could just take the platform, take the base, and then just gain one by one and understand, and we will just achieve our goals. I would like to hear all the voices. it's difficult not to agree with all their opinions because we don't have anything at all. That's why all options, all offers are very valuable ones. But just to sum up and in a nutshell, I would like to ask whether the interpreters working on this Ukrainian market in this region, where are they ready for this association, for this joint community? And if they agree on these rules, are they ready to fulfill, to implement these rules strictly? So are they ready to say no to clients and to lose their money? Is the this market ready for such formats of controlling authority, of controlling body? Because is this also very important function of this association? And one more question, whether it's possible or whether this active environment is ready or not? That is, and this environment speaks about, and very rightfully speaks about such a creation or establishment of such a station or community, whether this environment ready to have enough potential, appropriate level of potential to provide support to the members in case if. So how could they gain this reputation in order that any international organization really believes to this association, to this community, how to support, to foster the guarantees with some reasonable facts? Because it's very important to create this capacity building. And it could be just created by chance. We should work on it in systematic manner, maybe using experience and best practices of other associations of other countries. And I don't think that it's a bad idea to ask support and advices of, and maybe to listen to these advices and to implement them and harmonize them with our landscape. And no one would lose in this situation. And even if people say that this market could be just pushed by any person, any association, or is it just terminology issues, we would like to give a floor to Anya. Just a few short comment. I think a lot of people are afraid of establishment of such association, community, or any other entity because we will have Ukrainian industry standards. And if interpreters don't sign this standards, then these interpreters will be just out of the market and they will lose everything. And it will be just a terrific situation. But in the Western Europe is a very similar situation because we have international organizations and in their statutes or they have clear wording where they say that they should work only with IIC's interpreters or not. But in a lot of international organizations, they don't have such wording at all. And for example, if I come to these countries, I have an option to work with them because actually, thanks to the fact that they don't have this wording in their charters and their documents, and it's not bad, it's not good, it's just fact. It's just we will create only different sectors of the market. If someone doesn't want to sign the standards, this person could work with these clients, with those clients for whom the standards are not important or they don't have necessary budget or so on, so on. So we should not think that this is the only alternative for it. So
we have some time and I want to give the floor. So how do you see this? How do you envision this as some kind of punishing body? So some are members and now you just shouldn't need just to sign it and there should be a threshold and who is going to be making this decision? Who's going to make this decision? No, it's not mine. It's like if you join it, so such association should give information, first of all, and especially for the ones who come to the market. And if you come, you know, from nowhere, so either you get the information from colleagues or from the client. If the first clients will be bad, but they say that this is the rate, how do you get, and this is the rate, and then that's what's happening in the regions. And then you will continue, you know, making the rate, and they will be said, oh, really? So you can do this? And then if in the beginning of the your career, you know, it's not going to be a good colleague or a good client, that first of all, you know, this association should give the information. So there is no such minimal rate, but at least some general standards. So let's resume. So we were speaking about like the punishing function or controlling function. And Galina added the informational function. So it's the awareness of the, like developing awareness of the market. And I think that when we gradually came, you know, to something, you know, that we need some organization that joins us, and they say, again, you know, money to pay for the same fish. So this is the eternal speaking, you know, we can speak about it all the time, and here we are UTIC and we are great. Here it's not sarcasm. And I have a lot of colleagues, you know, the ones, you know, who I respect, and they are not interested in UTIC, and they are not worse, or they are not the professional, the UTIC. So the format of the meeting with their colleagues, I invited them to UTIC, I invited them to some discussions in Lviv. They're not coming. They're very good interpreters, professionals. So I can get deeper to the mentality, but I will not. I think, you know, it should be paid. I mean, so the membership should be used, and so this, for example, the lawyer should be paid from this money. For example, if people are not ready to come to have some coffee with colleagues, and how are they ready, you know, to pay the membership? And so these are the different segments of the market. Some people want to join their community. So I know one colleague, I respect her, I will not come because I'm introvert. And I'm supporting Anna. I think it's normal, you know, just different segments of the market. And from the constructive things, so now we say a controlling function, informational function, and also like the membership. So now we have a constructive thing. And then I wanted to add a very important function. If the market is formed and some standards are established, so it's also like amendments in the legislation. So they're not just words, but someone's standards, but just the working definitions, a reliable framework, so where you can work. So somebody should do that. It should be professional, and is someone, you know, should be paid for, and somebody should pay for that. And if the organization or the union or association, so if you choose the correct strategy and if you get this authority, then this question, you know, either join or not to join, pay or not to pay, it will be not up, you know. So the interpreters, we should motivate the interpreters, you know, to join the association. So in the first part, you're speaking about the lobbying, this. Yes, I got such an example in my head. Maybe I don't know the innovations in the legislation of that, and who is invited to the court interpreting. Who can do the court interpreting is like 40 minutes. Like I got interesting. Who can be doing this court interpreting? But I cannot quote. But as I remember, it's just this person should know the. Should know three languages, so like the language of like national language, or the foreign language, or the just language. There is no oath. There is no other standards. So this any person that knows, you know, these languages. So and we need to amend this legislation. So there is a gap in legislation. So what you cannot do, I think. And you can see it means it's a sign that the time is out. So we're very happy that you came. We're very happy that you're interested in this. We live in Odessa and Kharkiv. We work all over Ukraine and not only in Ukraine. So we are interested in the topics of the context. So we will be happy, you know, to talk to you on this topic. Thank you for taking part in the discussion. We understand that with the 15 minutes you cannot discuss everything. We hope that the contacts will be on the contact and you can get to us. So I'm here up to the 26th. Here, I'm leaving tomorrow. Yes, thank you very much. Well, and thank you very much to all the colleagues, to our colleagues Alexandra and Anna for their practical report. Thank you for your active discussion. And thank you for naming things, you know, what they are. So this is the problem. Why? Because we are hiding this information from each other and from the clients. And you need to get from this image, so get out of the shade, and all good will come for this. Now I'm going to cry, so it's very important. It's good because it's good that we cannot control this. It's something you cannot measure it. I wanted to measure all the love and respect to each other, so, but we should be ashamed that the only thing what is our balance is our very cheap rate. We need to think, you know, that our tariff shouldn't be so cheap, and we are professional, good at the very cheap ones. We can give what we have.